Good morning and welcome to Online Worship with St John's, Gourock. It is the 11th of August 2024. My name is Tamsin Munro and I am the Student Minister currently attached to Teri Peterson. Our reading this morning will be said by Anne Love. Let us join together with our call to worship, which this morning will be said in the form of a prayer inspired by Psalm 139. God, you shaped us first inside, then out. You formed us in the womb. We thank you, High God. You are breathtaking. Body and soul, we are marvellously made. We worship in adoration of your creation. You know us inside and out. We humble ourselves before you. Like an open book, you watch us grow from conception to birth. All the stages of life are spread out before you. We praise you, God, for your unconditional and everlasting love. Amen. I invite you now to join me in prayer with God. Gracious and loving God, we come together as your church family today, looking to you for guidance and assurance. We ask that you support us in hearing your words and knowing your will, not only for ourselves but for your church. God, you knitted us together in the womb, and you knit us together still as one church. For this we thank you. Ultimate Creator, you have shown us your unconditional love and grace through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. And you remind us of your unconditional love by the presence of your Holy Spirit day by day. God, you love us all, not in spite of our differences, but because in them, you have created us in your perfect image. We come to you today with open hearts. We know we come to you broken, and we ask that you forgive us. Forgive us for times when we have forgotten your love and your commandments, for times when we have been caught up in what's going on around us and have forgotten to focus on your love. We look to you, God, for forgiveness. For times we have not shown your love and in our actions or inactions. Merciful God, we thank you for the assurance of your forgiveness. We thank you for the security found in your love, knowing even when we fail to do good, you love us regardless, and provide us with alternative opportunities to share the compassion that Jesus shared. Compassionate Creator, as we enter this season exploring spiritual gifts, we ask for your guidance, for your support, to help us recognise the gracious gifts you have given us. And we ask for a more fervent spirit, that we may take these gifts and enter the world to spread your good news. God of all, equip us to embrace the gifts you have given us and use them for the benefit of your church and for all of your creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh, The reading today is from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 to 16, and I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, on the basis of God's mercy, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable act of worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in the proportion of faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the encourager in encouraging, the giver in sincerity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another, showing honour. Do not lack in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in affliction, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, pursue hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be arrogant, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, our God. Amen. What is in your heart? I don't mean the physical heart, but your spiritual heart, the one we all talk about. There's no denying that life comes from the heart. In fact, it plays a pretty important role in keeping us going. Again, I don't just mean the physical heart, but what you have on your spiritual heart is what motivates you, is what drives you, is what helps you recognise your purpose. Sappho, the Greek poet, wrote in the 7th century, "Love shook my heart, like the wind on the mountain, troubling the oak trees." Even in the 7th century, people would talk about how their heart moves them, motivates them, inspires them. Aristotle said that the heart held supremacy in all human process. Even today, the heart holds significance. In ancient Rome, it was believed that the ring finger on your left hand was directly connected to your heart. And to this day, many people still wear their wedding rings on their left ring finger to show their love for their spouse. Ancient Egypt believed that the heart was the seed of life, from which all things flow. In 2024, our understanding of the biological importance of the heart agrees with ancient Egypt, and in a way, I'm sure we could argue with Aristotle. But what does the Bible say? Deuteronomy 6:5 tells us to love the Lord our God with all your heart. In John 14:6, Jesus tells us he is the life. In Mark 12:30, Jesus declares the most important commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart. Historically, biblically, love and the heart go hand in hand. But how do we do that? And what does it have to do with our spiritual gifts? Let me introduce you to our good friend Paul. We may not always like what he has said, but here he provides us with a fabulous nugget of guidance. Paul outlines what he sees as the principles of Christian love and the importance of using your spiritual gifts to share God's love. Now I have a question. Do you know how many spiritual gifts there are? There is 24. 24! That is a lot in my eyes. Do we need to have them all? Well, no. In verse 2, Paul tells us, "Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God." What does conforming to this age mean? It will look different for many people, but we can't ignore the impact that the social media world has had on the real world. Constantly seeing the best of other people's lives and thinking, you should be doing the same. The truth is, just because one area of their house that you see is immaculately tidy, doesn't mean the rest is. Just because they seem to be super fit and healthy, doesn't mean they are happy. America Ferreira, her character in the Barbie movie, has a fabulous scene that sums up the pressures many women face. But it's not just a problem for women. It's not just the women who face these unrealistic expectations of being perfect all the time. Being transformed and renewed in our minds and discerning God's will helps to free us from these expectations and will allow us to live more freely and fully and contentedly for God. So let's forget the 24 spiritual gifts and focus today on three. Three that stem from the heart, that show God's love, and hopefully, if you have one of these, you will start to recognise it in yourself, or maybe even in others. A pretty crucial one to consider in a church environment is faith. Faith is a spiritual gift. It is not something that happens naturally for everyone. It can take time to build that relationship with God, to understand what it really means to have faith. Faith is not a one-size-fits-all. We should not be comparing our faith to others. We should be living it, whatever measure we have it in. Faith, much like the heart, is within us, and from it we act. We won't all wear our faith on our sleeves. A friend once said to me, "Faith is like a flame. Some people will talk about being on fire for God, but if you consider a bonfire, what happens if you load it with petrol and diesel? It burns hot and it burns fast. And if you're too busy adding petrol and nothing else to sustain it, it will burn out. However, if you have a gentle bonfire that is fed occasionally, it can last throughout the entire winter." Back home when I was much younger, my dad decided to start a bonfire. This was in the end of October. Every day he would go out and add a little more in it. In early December, it snowed, but that bonfire was still glowing gently underneath the snow because it was looked after every day. It wasn't big and showy and impressive, and dare I say it, you probably couldn't even toast a marshmallow on it. But it was there, and it survived far more than anybody would expect it to. As Paul writes in verse 12, rejoice in the hope, that faith, no matter how small, can last. Be patient and persevere, even when it seems like there is little to wait for. Faith as an action of love allows you to respond to adversity with grace, trusting God is in control. Even a lukewarm trust can grow warmer in the presence of God. Compassion is a far easier trait to understand as a part of the heart. If you have a heart for God and you want to show love, you may consider it compassion, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's one of our spiritual gifts. I guess the general expectation of compassion is that people with compassion make everyone happy. They're the bringers of joy. Not inappropriate joy, unlike a window in Port Glasgow that you see on the train who still has Santa on the window, but a joy that brings a genuine smile to your soul. Compassion gives joy that shines from the inside. It comes from recognising someone's need and meeting it. Here is where I disagree with Paul, at least according to this translation. Compassion is not necessarily cheerful. When someone is in a period of struggle, what do? Do you invite them out to a party? Or do you pick up their shopping for them? It's easy to confuse joy and cheer for compassion. But as a spiritual gift, we need to look deeper at the meaning and the actions that someone will naturally take who holds this gift. Compassion can involve sitting with someone whilst they cry. It could be having someone round for a cup of tea. In some cases, it could be an unprompted phone call just to see how someone is. It sounds simple, but the spiritual gift of compassion requires a genuine love, a genuine empathy, kindness, and concern for others. It's more than just actions, but a deep and true care for others. You may be like me and be someone who is compassionate, but doesn't quite have the spiritual gift of compassion. We may have a deep concern for others, but the busyness of life might take up more of our focus than we would like. But that's okay. We don't all have to have the same spiritual gifts, or even the spiritual gifts that we add more value to. Last, but by no means least, we have exhortation, which is a form of encouragement. This is a great gift to start with on our season of spiritual gifts, because we need those who can encourage us. Some of us need help in realising and finding our gifts. Hopefully, we can find some of our encouragers this week to help others throughout the coming weeks. Thinking of encouragers, I am thinking of cheerleaders. I am someone who needs cheerleaders in my life, but I think most of us do. At big sporting events, it is far more common for teams to win home games, and I believe, with no evidence, that this is due to the support of the cheerleaders that they have, or fans as we call ourselves. The thing is, we can't always be filled with this zest for life, especially not for ourselves. And this is when we really need to lean on our encouragers. What an encourager is not. An encourager is not someone who says yes to everything and supports you even if they think you may fail. They're not someone who talks gently to you all the time. But an encourager is someone who is strict, but they see you for you and they know your talents. There is absolutely a role for encouragers to be motivating and uplifting. But they also have a huge part to play in helping people overcome challenges. And sometimes that means pushing people when we maybe don't want to be pushed. We don't always end up with talents and gifts that we want. And so sometimes we need a gentle push to utilise them. Our encouragers have a special role in bringing us all together for the good of the church, helping us work with others and embrace our role in conjunction with others. They inspire and encourage us to live out our faith, to live as we are called. Our encouragers are often forgotten about in discussions about spiritual gifts, but they have such a key role that really starts at the heart of the church. Everyone can benefit from time with an encourager, but most definitely the church. We have many reasons to be encouraged. We have the love of God behind us, the gifts God has given us within us. But sometimes to see this, we need the eyes of our encouragers. In the spirit of encouragement, I encourage you to go forth this week, considering your talents, assessing where your gifts may be, and judging your actions soundly. Don't dismiss acts as lowlier than others. Your gift is just as valuable as that of others. So do you have a faith that burns brightly or slow and steady? Do you share joy and meet others in compassion? Or do you recognise in others what they may not see in themselves? Can you help your fellow congregants understand their value in God's plan? Amen.
Many a dream have died. Like a tree planted by the water, we will never run dry. Living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire. Just to
possible, just to know you.
one to make you known. We lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. We know we were made for so much more.
Let us join together with God again in prayer. Lord of sea and sky, Lord of tall and small, Lord of young and old, God of all, hear our praise and prayers to you. We bring you thanks for giving us this space, space to praise you without fear, space to be entirely ourselves without judgment. Space to explore the gifts you've given. We thank you for the diversity, for the variety, not only of gifts in this space, but for the variety of people who make up your church of faith, compassion, and exhortation. We thank you for the complexity of all your creation. We thank you for reminding us that even something as small as our fingers need our heart to work. We thank you for the connection we can explore and for reminding us that all good things come from you. Thank you, God, for knowing the positive in all of us, even when we may not see it in ourselves. We pray that you give us the courage and wisdom to see this in others. As we grow in your love, help us to grow others also. In this moment, we think of all those who do not know your love, of all those who feel excluded. Please let them know that they always have a space in your house. Help us to be quicker to welcome people, to recognize their gifts, and to recognize their value. In these times of conflict, help us to be as passionate as you. May we remember your grace in all our interactions. Let us to continue to seek justice for those like us and for those not, recognizing that all people are your people, deserving of safety, love, and respect. May we be a light in our communities to show how unique and useful we all can be to your world. Grant our leaders the humility to see the gifts they hold, the spirit to know your compassion, and the grace to discern the actions needed for the betterment of all people in all places. God, we ask that the passion that we see on our mobiles and televisions be transformed into a passion for love and acceptance. The passion for compassion, as taught to us by Jesus. And on this 11th day of the month, we join our hearts as your church family to pray for all those who live and work in the Castlelevin area. We pray for the leaders of St. John's congregation, for the elders, the Kirk Session, the Session Clerk and Assistant Session Clerk, and for the Treasurer. We pray for the land, people and governments of the nations of Mauritania, Senegal, the Gambia, Guinea-Bissau, Guinea and Sierra Leone. Hear our prayers, God, both personally and as one church. Let all of our prayers and concerns be comforted by you, Almighty One. God, as we need our hearts to live, let them be filled with love for you, that all we do may come from your love and be done for your church and creation. We pray these and all things, as Jesus taught us to say.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us the wrong we have done, as we forgive those who have wronged us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
May we all leave this place with love, ready to share God's love, embracing the gifts that we have through God to grow and encourage all people, remembering that we are fearfully and wonderfully made just as we are. And may the grace of Jesus, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all and all those whom we love, now and forevermore. Amen.